Happy Islam Awareness Week. I have two quick announcements that I put on the board. One is there's this institution, it's actually a thing, called the Peace Boat that goes on tours around the world, and Amy and Shannon and I have seen it, and Carrie, it's definitely real. It's the biggest damn thing you ever saw. And it's kind of expensive, but you know, think of it as a cruise. And the U.S. leader of the Peace Boat is coming to campus next week on Tuesday. We're trying to set up a meeting for her so she can tell you what it's like, if she'd be interested. As you know from CourseWeb, the PAX 164B is on the books now. It's a kind of small room, Warren Hall, which is probably going to be okay because we're getting the word out so late, but that's when and where the course will be. I don't have the course control number with me, but I put it out on CourseWeb for you. Okay, and now I think that's the only announcements, so I'd like to roll on into the civil rights movement and the end of it. And we are going to be exactly one day behind schedule because the syllabus says that we're going to be talking about the legacy today. But that will actually be on Tuesday. And we discussed some really important issues last time, like maybe what really does make principled nonviolence psychologically possible under really tough circumstances. We haven't yet discussed how that influence of that personal change transfers itself to other people, but I was really glad we had that discussion and we can continue it. But I'm going to try to sort of step through the events and pick out particular key points of interest for us in our usual fashion, that is looking for general principles illustrated in specific concrete events. And wherever possible, though it's going to take a little bit of more time, I'd like to read you the direct words of Martin Luther King on these subjects, because if anybody could write and speak more passionately than Gandhi, it was King. Eknath Ishwaran, who is my spiritual teacher and who wrote two of the books that we've got, a book on Abdul Ghaffar Khan and Gandhi the Man, he heard Martin Luther King speak when he was in Minnesota in the late 50s. And he had never heard of him. Just one night there were posters all over the campus that Martin Luther King would be speaking. And so he went to hear him, and he said he could not believe it. He thought he was listening to Gandhi. And not since he had heard Gandhi had he heard that passion and that purity. So I'll be, to the greatest extent possible, relying on his words. And I'd like us to think about, I have about five questions here, which partly pick up the ones we're already considering. Okay, what is the overall shape of this movement, this rhythm thing that we've been talking about? Does it have phases? Does it escalate? Does it have a climax the way we said the Dharasan assault raids was the climax of the Indian freedom struggle? Does it kind of come apart at the end? Does it, in other words, evoke problems which tend to break up its momentum toward the end of the movement? Of course, you'll not be overwhelmed with surprise to hear that I think the answer to that question is yes. So what exactly were those problems? We talked about the introduction of the 101st Airborne into Little Rock, and I want to get back to that when we get up to that episode. It's more than just the way that Gandhi appealed to the crown for help, because he did not ask the crown to intervene militarily. He just wanted it to intervene legally. So this is a step beyond that. I mean, even St. Augustine faced this issue where he had to call upon military generals to keep order in North Africa, and it leads you into a very, very awkward position. So Obviously, we feel uncomfortable about having those soldiers there in Little Rock, in Central High. It's clearly not a persuasion thing to have National Guardsmen tramping around with guns, but I'm not sure that this totally means that under the circumstances, given what was available, was this the, quote, wrong thing to do? Did it set the movement back? I'm not sure about that. I want to discuss that with you in a little while. Then let me read you, see if I got the right thing here. Yeah. Read you from another great book of King's, which you have in your big anthology. Where do we go from here? Chaos or community? This is question number two. He's talking about the achievements of the civil rights movement, and he says the historic achievement is found in the fact that the movement in the South has profoundly shaken the entire edifice of segregation. This is an accomplishment whose consequences are deeply felt by every Southern Negro in his daily life, or assumedly her daily life. It is no longer possible to count the number of public establishments that are now open. The persistence of segregation is not the salient fact of Southern experience anymore. The proliferating areas in which the Negro moves freely is the new advancing truth. The South was the stronghold of racism. Now, actually, that's a bit of an exaggeration. It's been said, and I think it's true, that there's as much racism in the North, but it's a different kind. In the South, you could get as close as you wanted as long as you didn't get high. And in the North, you could get as high as you wanted as long as you didn't get close. But it ends up being as deeply entrenched and in terms of its ultimate consequences, probably just about as vicious in the North. So King and the movement in general, they have this success in the Southland. He's from there. Most of the people are there. We're going to see several of the major episodes in the movement are not started by people outside those communities, although, as Gerlina was pointing out, you do have to bring non-white people and non-Southern people into it at key moments, and we'll be talking about this a lot next semester, because although the theory is that one person could do it herself, and you don't need any, you don't need numbers, you definitely don't need outside interference, intervention, shall we say, in theory, the fact of the matter is that if you look at the nonviolent insurrections that have taken place in the last 40 or so years, the correlation between those that got international attention and those that succeeded is a very close fit. It's like if you didn't get the attention of the international community, you failed. So, all right, you do need some help from people outside the community, but it is still basically a Southern movement, and it works very well there. And this is the issue that I'm leading up to here and talking about is what? I'll give you a big hint. Which sva word applies here? Alex? Svadeshi. Yeah. Because it's a region. The region has a culture, and the people working on that region are doing a form of constructive program, though it has to be very obstructive in some ways, in their region. And as King points out, having done it right in the region, it then spreads to the rest of the country. And so as far as that's concerned, the Swadeshi formula is working for us very well. But we get to a point in the movement where he goes north. And that raises a question for us. He has some conspicuous setbacks in the North. I think Chicago was worse than Albany, Georgia for him. It was worse than Fort Lauderdale, Florida, which was, he called it the most lawless city in the nation. And that raises a question for us. Similarly, the next question I want us to think about, I'm lining these out now because I have so much material I want to share with you. I'm not at all sure we're going to get to it, so I want to have this at least in the back of our mind. So we have the gray area of invoking the military force at Little Rock. We have the moving beyond your cultural circle. What was the timing of that? After all, we're saying that Gandhi's career had two phases, but the second phase was closer to Swadeshi than the first phase, right? Because he starts in South Africa, 1,000 or so miles from home. He comes back to India. King, on the other hand, starts in the south and moves into a different cultural zone where things are expressed differently. Was there a loss of efficiency due to a violation of Swadeshi in that move? Once again, let me hasten to submit. I'm not saying it was necessarily wrong, because we're talking with the real world now and having to act within constraints. Dan? Well, it's definitely not the same as moving from South Africa to India, because you're moving closer to your Swadeshi in Gandhi's case. But King is moving outside. Now, remember, you know, it's not the fact that it's in the same nation state that really matters. What matters is communication. And remember Gandhi's reason for not getting embroiled in the uplift of black Africans. Because they wouldn't understand me. They, you know, they probably have just as much nonviolence, but they express it in a different way. Whereas in India, all he has to do is say, this little community I've just started is called Sabarmati Ashram. Get it? Ashram. And everybody knows that he's leading a spiritual movement. Whereas, you know, to the Xhosa or the Zulu, wouldn't have had that much meaning. So, it is plausible that by moving from the south, where he was among his own people, quote unquote, to going up to Chicago and places like that, he was getting outside his cultural area. So the question we'd have to ask is one of timing. Because remember, Swadeshi doesn't say, hey, you get back in your cultural area and you stay there. What it says is you start there, and when your job is done there, it will expand without you doing anything, but also if you want to move out into a larger area, you can. So you see why I'm raising
this? Yeah, just because it seemed like India is a huge country too, and it had cultural differences.
There are definitely cultural differences in India, God knows. I mean, there are like 200 basically not mutually intelligible languages going on in India. It's a country of enormous diversity compared to the U.S. You know, you go to a shopping, if you parachuted you into a shopping mall tomorrow and took your blindfolds off, you would not know what city you were in or what region or anything. So it's an enormously diverse civilization, but at the same time, there's a cultural continuity to it. Even across the communal boundaries of Hindu, Muslim, still there's appeal to spirituality that works pretty much the same way, even though one group says, hey, you know, let's have hamburgers for lunch, and the other group says this is the greatest possible sin. Still, you know, underneath all of those particular ways, there's, if you go to a religious Sufi in India and a religious Hindu in India, they will be on the same wavelength. So whether or not I'm right about India, and there's no reason that I should be, I've never set foot on the place, but whether or not I'm right about India, the general principle obtains. It's a question of, if you're talking about social Swadeshi as opposed to personal Swadeshi, it's a question of whom can you communicate readily with? Who will look upon you as a native son, or as we say in the urban areas, a homeboy? Who will consider you a homie? Okay? So that's the question, and I can't promise you will arrive at answers to any of these questions, but these are the important issues that I see coming out of the movement. Another one, and this, I'm not just making it up, this was explicitly raised and raised as a direct criticism thrown at King by people in the movement and outside of it. And that was the famous Riverside Church talk of 1967, where he came out against the war in Vietnam. So what's our issue here? What are we calling this? Amy? No fresh issue. Is this a fresh issue? And I'm just putting it out there for now with a question mark. Finally, two more questions, I guess. Yes, John?
When Gandhi made that radio speech about God in the U.S., what was the point of that? Or how was that not going outside?
Well, that, I think Gandhi assumed that there would be people who believed in God in America. At the time, of course, that was wrong. Now we have them in the highest offices in the land, having prayer breakfasts and getting ready for Armageddon. I'm just being sarcastic. But note that his definition of God in that speech was about as non-sectarian as you could possibly be. He did not say, I do dimly perceive that God is blue and he's wearing a peacock feather and he has four arms. He's dancing on my ego. He said, I do dimly perceive that whilst all around me is ever changing, there's something that isn't changing. That's about as universal a definition as you can possibly get. I think that was not a violation of Sudeshi to talk to Americans. To come here and try to get involved in American politics and raise some movements here, that might have been a problem. But by the time he had finished doing his ocular demonstration, to use his words, that you had so many Indians coming over here as advisors, I'm going to characterize that as educational intervention, which is totally appropriate. It better be, because that's what I'm doing with my life. But in fact, there was a time when the ideology on the left was so rigid that people were not just opposed, they were morally outraged if, for example, someone like me would offer, let's say you had this nonviolent movement in Tabasco going on. If I were to go down there and share some of what I think are the general principles of nonviolence, there were people in the left in those days who would call that peace imperialism, say I'm arrogant and I'm a white male, part of which is undeniable, and namely the arrogance part. and I didn't see it that way then, and I don't see it that way now. And I think you can point to the results. I am one who believes, with Gandhi and Kant and a few other heavyweights, that if you do the right thing, it will have a positive effect in the long run. And I think we can say that the results of not sharing what we know about nonviolence with incipient movements around the world have been disastrous. And the results of sharing them have been amazingly efficient. And I'm not just talking about, you know, work, quote unquote, get winning, but uplifting consciousness and making positive changes. So I'm unwilling to say that going around the world and sharing information is wrong.
Yeah. So then with that logic, how can we discount Martin Luther King for speaking out against the war when that's, it's not like he was leading an anti-draft movement. It's just like sharing his opinion as much as Gandhi would against segregation here.
It's a good point. You're Amos, right?
Yeah.
If there's a new fresh issue, it would be because he had based his whole reputation on civil rights and suddenly he's stepping outside of it. Now, I'm not saying it was a violation of a new fresh issue, but I'm saying it was called that, even by people who didn't know the term. So it wasn't because, after all, he's an American citizen, right? His country is waging this war. He gets to speak out. But the platform he's using, and this is another, to bring in another point, the legitimacy that he had was as a person who had stood up against racism. So what was involved in him expanding that circle, or shall we say stepping outside that circle, to talk about war fighting? And there's no question, one second, Amy, there's no question that he alienated Johnson, partly around that issue and partly around the poverty issue, because Johnson prided himself on building the great society and there was going to be no poverty. He was finished. Amy? Racism, materialism, and militarism. Well, since we're there already discussing this issue, which I was just kind of flagging for us to get to it, but who cares? If it's not a no fresh issue, how would you characterize it? It's definitely a change of focus, right? It's a change of issue. I mean, after all, let's contrast, although King himself had nothing to do with it, let's contrast the 101st Airborne marching into Central High, Trump, 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 with their Garand A1 rifles on their shoulders. Contrast that with saying, my nation is the greatest purveyor of militarism in the world. Amen?
I think whether it's no fresh issue or not, it might be an issue of just a misdefinition of what his original issue was. Because
yes.
I don't think he would ever claim that his original issue was purely racism. More an issue of equality of human life across the board. So that covers the scope of the war,
yeah,
poverty, and everything. So I think the racism issue was sort of just how that touched down most readily,
right,
where he was. And so I would say it's the same issue,
yeah,
just sort of widening the scope. Maybe,
yeah,
the public wasn't ready for it.
Yeah. Well, I totally agree with you, and I think you put that very well. It was this was the issue all along. And racism is just where that issue touched the ground for him there. And it was very swadeshi of him to deal with racism in the South from his pulpit. That was the swadeshi way to start. I would even go maybe a half step further, Amos, and I think he says as much. But I'm not sure where, that in a way for me, I think this was a deepening of the issue. This was a getting down to the root cause of the issue, which is what he said about the first go-round with racism. He said, by getting at racism where it is most entrenched and most legitimated by legalization in the South, most in your face, he has gotten at racism everywhere. But I was going to be leading up to this with big dramatic fanfare, roll of snare drums and so forth, but here it is, so I'll just tell you right now, hope it's not anticlimactic. When we talk about what, in the end, he and the movement really achieved, I believe we could make this generalization that he and they, it succeeded in delegitimating racism. Not just him, but actually Hitler helped. You know, he had made racism so ugly that people were sent reeling in shock. And so then now when he sweeps in and humanizes black people, he kind of puts a death knell on the legitimacy of racism. But to finish my sentence, I don't think for some reason he quite succeeded in delegitimizing violence. And that's as far as he got. That's my real overview of what the achievement of the movement was. And that's where the dream has to be carried now. This is the task of our generation. For the moment, I'm identifying with you and your generation. but we have to, I think, do exactly what he did, which is to carry the thing step by step closer to the belly of the beast. And when you stop and think about it, is this not what Gandhi did? He dealt with rights and discrimination in an outlying colony, and when he succeeded there, he said, okay, now let's carry this home. So that in the end, I think, as far as the Swadeshi thing is concerned, we have kind of a mixed bag. It was perfectly okay in several ways. One of them, the most important one perhaps, being that if you really, okay, I guess I have to finish my little formula now. If you really want to eliminate racism as opposed to delegitimating it, you have to delegitimate and eliminate violence, because racism is a form of violence. As long as there is violence, it will take whatever form it wants to touch down at in your particular situation. So you could get rid of every single line of racial legislation in a regime. You can dehabituate people from the practices of racism, and if they still don't have a nonviolent worldview, it's potentially going to come back. It's just like they said about the atomic bomb. We could dismantle every atomic bomb on the planet, which I think would be fantastic, but we won't be able to take the knowledge of how to build them out of people's minds. As long as there's a University of California, I'm embarrassed to say, there will be highly paid scientists, again, my jealousy speaking, who are, as Tom Barnett once said, you know, we say that nuclear war is unthinkable, but we pay tens of thousands of people to think about it every single day. So we really need to get down to the root, and I think that's exactly what Martin Luther King was doing. But the fact is that strategically it did not work very well, because he alienated a lot of his own followers, and he alienated Johnson, because this was Johnson's pet little war. You know, I won't even quote to you some of the phrases that he used, because they're not suitable for mixed company, about what he was doing to Ho Chi Minh and things like that. Johnson was a very complex person. There are those who say, we're never going to get to half of this material, I hope that's all right with you. And there are those who say, now this is a really unfortunate thing to have to be considering. But the fact is that nobody really knows who assassinated Martin Luther King. That's the legal process there has been stymied, and that truth has not come out. There are those who believe that the reason that King was assassinated is that he went against the war, and that the powers that be, believe it or not, we like to think of them as primarily racist, but racism is just a tool for them. And I had in the early days of peace and conflict studies, we had a famous couple from the South, Miles and Wilma Horton, came up here to speak, and you know, black sharecroppers in origin from Mississippi, and I just practically dropped my jaw open. They got up to speak to my students, and the first thing they said was, you know what, folks? Racism had nothing to do with it. It's about greed and class discrimination, and racism was a convenient way to organize it. But they were as vicious to poor white trash as they were to black sharecroppers. So now that might be an exaggeration to say racism has nothing to do with it, but it, in a funny way, violent and ugly and clear as it is, such an obviously clear violation of humanity, there couldn't be a clearer one, it isn't the root issue. The root issue is violence itself. And so we're looking at this in two different ways. We're saying that King was homing in on the Vietnam War as the manifestation of violence, knowing full well that that's what he was after all along, and unless he was able to do something about that, he would not have permanently resolved the racial issue. And then if you believe in this particular conspiracy theory, the powers that be were really alarmed when he said, and he did, that he was going to organize another march on Washington, only this time it was going to go to the Pentagon, and it was going to be about the Vietnam War. And it was shortly after that that he was assassinated. So we're left here with just a horrible, unscientific inference, and you know there's no way of proving this one way or the other. I hope that I'm totally wrong, and none of this stuff is going on. But I have a sickening, disquieting feeling that I'm not. Usually I love being wrong. Jarlena?
I can say in terms of that issue, that, I mean, he did what he did, and of course I was in the Vietnam War is an issue, but there was also so much violence going on in the black community by that time.
Yep.
That the feeling was speaking out about it, but I think him taking more action might have been beneficial.
Not only more action would have been beneficial to help resolve the violence within the black community, but this is a criticism, if you will, that I think may have some validity. But as soon as I finish saying this, I'm going to talk about all of these criticisms. This criticism may have some validity that when it comes to constructive program, he talked about it, but he didn't do a whole lot about it. Whereas Gandhi said, I don't care how long it takes, I'm going down to the smallest hardscrabble village in the remotest corner of India, and I'm going to get people to clean their latrines with my bare hands and plant better crops and start educating them and build it up from there. So then when he would go to people and say, you have economic independence, you don't need to rely on British cloth or British anything else, he had actually put the stuff in their hands. He had put the bread on their table. Whereas Martin Luther King didn't go quite that far. He said, we can do boycotts, we have buying power, and we have got to stop the drinking and the violence and all the rest of it. But he didn't actually build constructive program very much. That probably was a problem that probably somewhat limited his effectiveness. But now let me hasten to add, about all these criticisms, to the extent that they're valid, we have to weigh something against that criticism, those criticisms, in the other pan. And that's the letter from Birmingham Jail, where all of these white ministers say to him, oh, you're going to get emancipated eventually, you know, why push it, why raise all of this ill will, this dust? And he said, in effect, paraphrasing him, he said a couple of things. You know, you don't understand what it's like to live like this for 100 years. There comes a point where you lose your humanity and you can't get it back, and you cannot let that happen. You were moving from, if you will, a form of poverty to a form of cultural destitution. But the other part of the question is this, it's also the timing question. You get these windows of opportunity in the real world. We cannot have the free speech movement next Thursday, unfortunately. Don't ask me why. If I declare a rally next Thursday, even though we now have the internet, and then all we had was coffee shops. And in fact, we didn't have very good coffee, for that matter. Even though we have all these wonderful communication techniques, you know perfectly well, if I were to call a rally against some issue, you know, Zoe and Emily and Maya and another handful of people would be there. I know, because I've done 2 rallies in the last couple of years, and it's kind of disappointing if you were in the free speech movement and used to hearing roars of approval from 20,000 people. It's really terrible for your ego. But that's not the point. The point is, let me remind myself, the point is, for reasons which we don't fully understand, tipping points happen. Consciousness suddenly explodes across a whole community of people. I've already mentioned the example that we'll talk about next semester of getting General Pinochet out of power in Chile. Wouldn't it have been lovely if you could have called a meeting with him every Tuesday, let's say, take him out for some sangria, and talk to him about why you shouldn't torture people, especially if they're pregnant, and things like that. And slowly, over a period of 10 years, persuaded him to step down. That would be ideal. That would be persuasion, not coercion. But in the real world, the opportunity was boot his blankety-blank out of there or put up with 12 to 15, who knows how many more years of brutal military dictatorship. Likewise, the civil rights movement happened at a time for a reason. And I believe that even in terms of his personal career, that Martin Luther King knew that he wasn't going to live very much longer. And he knew that he had to get what he could get when he could get it. And so all the things that we feel uncomfortable with and should feel uncomfortable with from the point of view of principled nonviolence, they have to be weighed against the realities of the situation. It either was to get something or get nothing. Okay. Now, Dan, did you still have a comment or question?
I think I did.
Okay. Well, then I forgot my answer. Well, where shall we go from here? Sorry, terrible pun. Let's talk about the events that we have on our little chronology. And you now have it out there on CourseWeb, and maybe think of some way of getting it on the out for the webcast people. Can you do a screenshot of this? No, okay. The event that we probably know best for various reasons, because he writes Stride Toward Freedom about it, is the bus boycott. And I want to point out something about actually, now that I look at it, one, two, three, four, the first five events were not started by Martin Luther King. The bus boycott, as we know, he was just being a black Baptist minister at that point, and following the footsteps of Daddy King. And as every one of us knows very well, it was Rosa Parks who had been radicalized slash educated at Highlander Folk School. One day, for reasons known only to herself and God, she said no and decided not to move to the back of the bus. She was not just anybody. She was a very prominent and respected and loved person in the community. The community pulled together to decide what to do about this. And it's in that context that Martin Luther King rises to the position of leadership at age 26. Little Rock, not only did he not instigate it, he had absolutely nothing to do with it. And if you read books by people like Melba Beals, who writes a book called Soldiers Don't Cry. She was one of the nine black high schoolers who integrated that school. The whole book, from cover to cover, she never mentions the name of Martin Luther King. I have a feeling there may even have been some bad blood there. Greensboro, on February 1st, 1960, four students from North Carolina A&T, that's probably agriculture and technology, they were talking. It's always dangerous for students to talk to one another. They decided, that was a joke, they decided to, why don't we just walk in and sit down at the lunch counter and just not go away till they serve us. So that was February 1st. By the 10th of February, it had spread across five states. And let me read you. I'm partly talking about the issue of leadership here. I was afraid of that. Looks like I've got the wrong book. Autobiography, page 54. We'll have to go back and erase the last 5 minutes of that tape. I had the wrong site there. But so now when it comes to the next year, 1961, the Freedom Rides, we can't say he had nothing to do with it. Those were organized by the Congress of Racial Equality Corps, and they were in turn sponsored by Fellowship of Reconciliation. Incidentally, one of the things I didn't put on this list, partly because I didn't know how to get Microsoft Word to do 5 columns instead of 4. I worked for a couple of weeks to get this to come out right. I haven't discussed the organizations. Drillina mentioned them, but it is in itself an interesting story because you had, for 100 years, you had organizations that were dedicated to the amelioration of the position of black people in the South. You had, of course, the Colored Porters, what was that one called exactly? The Brotherhood of Negro Porters or something like that.
Sleeping Car Porters,
that's right. And then, of course, you had the famous NAACP, which still is in existence. But the thing that sprang forth in the civil rights movement was way beyond their, that was out of the box for them. And if they had wanted to be involved, they would have had to have changed very deeply and very quickly. And that led to tension and ill feeling and loss of resources and so forth. But I'm not talking too much about organizations, but Fellowship of Reconciliation, based way up north, played an important role. I was in their main offices in Nyack about 5, 6 years ago. And they're housed in a beautiful old mansion. Somebody gave it to them. Someone from FOR was riding on a train with this person, and he told him that, you know, we have this organization, we're looking for a place. He said, well, I got a place for you, and he gave him this huge mansion on about 5 acres right on the Hudson River. Unbelievable. So I was walking around drooling, I mean, enjoying the meeting all these people, and my eye was caught by a little 3x5 card, you know, like a file card that they used to have before they had computers. It was up on the mantelpiece, and you know, Richard Dietz said, oh, you want to see that? Go have a look. I picked it up. It was an enrollment card. Someone had just paid $25 to join the Fellowship of Reconciliation, and I looked down at the signature. It was Martin Luther King, Jr. That was his enrollment. It was probably 1955 or something like that. So he did get involved in that. But then again, in Albany, the thing was started without him being there, and he was dragged into it most unwillingly, was not able to control it very much, and in fact, it was one of the famous failures of the movement. Now, leadership is one of our questions. I have mentioned one thing about Gandhi's style of leadership. I want to add another in case I haven't mentioned it yet. The one I have mentioned is that Gandhi said, when we get rolling, which we're, you know, satyagraha in the smaller sense, obstructive program is rolling, there's no time for democracy. He didn't say that, but I'm saying that. We're not going to sit down and have a town meeting, all right? I am your general. I expect you to obey me implicitly. The difference being that in the case of an actual 5-star general, you can't fire them if you don't like what they're doing anymore, unless you're the commander-in-chief of the armed forces. Whereas with Gandhi, he said, the moment you people don't want me here, I'm out of here. But if you want me to be your general, then you have to do what I say, otherwise I can't function. The other thing about his style of leadership that he insisted on, and I may have put an article in the Reader that says this, I don't quite remember whether I got it in there or not. He also said, I have never really started anything. I watch the people very carefully. I sense what they want, and I help facilitate it for them. Now, in a way, this is also going to be King's style of leadership. There are some events where he sits down with Abernathy and Shuttlesworth and Andy Young and Jesse Jackson and all the rest of them, and he says, where should we go from here? What's our next move? what's the issue, how do we do it? But those were in the minority, and most of these things were very grassroots in terms of the spark plug that got them started. In some of them, he didn't even have an opportunity to get involved, but in others, he came in just to lend what resources and prestige and legitimacy that he could. Okay, so starting with the Montgomery bus boycott, there was an episode or two. Hopefully this is the right book this time. Yeah. I don't know where my head was when I was writing down all these page numbers. You know, all these little hard soft cover books look so much alike. One more book. Ah, okay. The movement almost fell apart around a very interesting setback at a meeting with the White Citizens Council of Montgomery when they were almost, they had almost reached agreement when somebody said to the sheriff or whoever was there, if we do this, the Negroes will say that they won and that is intolerable. To me, this was very, very clear. They had just worked out all the issue. Remember my saying from the get-go, one of the things that a nonviolent person believes is there are no unresolvable conflicts of interest, really. When you get down to basic needs, there is no reason any person or group has to fight with another person or group. And the most dramatic example of that was the one I borrowed from Johann Galtung, who traveled around, did a lot of interviews, came to the conclusion that the needs of the West are access to cheap oil, and the needs of the Islamic people in the Middle East are for respect for their religion. There's absolutely no reason why we have to be carrying on this ghastly conflict. But to say there's no reason doesn't mean that there isn't a cause. There is a cause, and the cause is ego. There's a really neat book that's come out that I saw in some book catalog that has a button. I don't know if it's a real button. If it is, I want to buy one. It says, it's the ego, stupid. That's a real issue. It's not the economy. It's not immigration. It's not gay marriages. It's not abortion. It's the reason we're fighting one another is all about ego. And this was a very clear example of that, and it sunk in for King, and he internalized that lesson. They worked it all out on the level of detail. There was no reason why they couldn't integrate the buses. And as a matter of fact, when they did integrate them, the whole thing was over in 24 hours. In 24 hours, you riding on a bus in Montgomery, you would not have known that there had ever been segregation in that city. The first 24 hours was a bit uncomfortable. There was one lady who was sitting on a bus, and a black person sat down next to her, and she said, huh, what will these, won't use the word, think of next? But that was about the extent of it. And then by the end of the week, it was like it had never been any different. So it's a very good illustration that the underlying problems can always be resolved. And what makes it into conflict is ego. And therefore, from this point on, King was very careful not to, he was very careful to discourage triumphalism in people. Now, let's not go around crowing and saying, ha ha, we won, you know, take that, Whitey. you don't do that. He said it's very important to avoid the psychology of a victor. Yeah, and your name again is?
Elizabeth.
Elizabeth.
Is it right that, I was reading this and I wasn't sure if I was reading it the right way, that part of the agreement or what they were fighting for was that it would be on a first-come, first-served basis on the buses, but that whites would sit front to back and blacks would sit front to back. Is that right?
White, back to front.
Back to front.
Yes. That was the agreement at one stage, but it was complicated by the fact that the federal government stepped in and outlawed it. So right at the same time when the White Citizens Council, or the City Council, rather, was saying, no, you can't do this, the federal legislation was making it irrelevant. So, but yes, it was really a very gentle compromise that they were going for. They were not saying that it's just totally mixed, there isn't a trace of segregation going to be left. But yeah, if you're black, you start at the back, come forward. If you're white, start at the front, go backwards. And if you overlap, that's okay also, as long as you don't actually have children right there on the bus. But everybody knew that this was a step towards complete. Because once you break the mystique is that whites are privileged, blacks are not, and contact with them is contaminating. The minute you show that contact with them is not contaminating, the mystique is broken, the legitimacy is gone, and then it's just a matter of time before it'll be more complete desegregation, integration. John, I think you had
it. Yeah, it sounds kind of like non-embarrassment. Is there like a term that applies to this, you know, not having to be ego about it?
I think the only term for it is non-triumphalism, or just to avoid triumphalism. Remember, non-embarrassment, as we use the term, is a technical term with a limited range of applications. I wouldn't apply it here. But the concept, let's call it non-humiliation to distinguish it from, quote, non-embarrassment, unquote. Non-humiliation is the big principle. You never humiliate anyone, and you never accept humiliation from another person. That's critical. But non-triumphalism is very similar to no fresh issue in a way. And do you see why I'm saying that? What did I claim is the underlying reason for not admitting a fresh issue when you've got a little bit of momentum, you've got some clout? Why don't you? Shannon?
It changes from a conversation to how it starts.
Right, because it changes your relationship, your interaction, from a conversational one, the point of which is education and reconciliation, to a power struggle, the point of which is domination and winning. So similarly, triumphalism would psychologically reinterpret the conflict that you just had in the terms of a power struggle and winners and losers. Interpretation can be all important because of this principle that there is no real conflict among us. Every now and then, I like to use an example from ancient Greeks just to show that my whole education was not a complete waste. There was a battle that took place among these two city-states in Greece. It was around the middle of the 4th century BC, I believe, and the winning party, they had some of their people were dead, and they were out of reach on the other side, but they had won. They won the battle. They'd driven the other guys off the field. But then they went and said, if you don't mind, we're coming across to get our corpses. And those people said, no, we don't mind. Come on ahead. Let them come in. Let them get their corpses, and immediately declared victory. Because that was the symbol. If you could go and collect, if you had to come in over and collect your dead, you were the loser. So it had nothing to do with the fact that they had a lot more people who had died, nothing to do with the fact that they literally had turned tail and run off the field. It wasn't the facts on the ground that we're always talking about. It was the interpretation of those facts in the mind, where ego has full reign, that really gives you your final payoff in terms of your relationship and nonviolence. Okay, still on Montgomery. And on the end of the struggle, there is a really important event, two important events, really. One of them is that there's a final spasm of bomb throwing. Some people threw some bombs. And again, it's kind of an interpretation thing. What was the response to the bombs that were thrown after desegregation was already in place? The response was nada, nothing, nichts. People decided to ignore it. And amazingly enough, when they ignored it, it had no effect. So what's the very, very deep Gandhian principle that applies here? I think we've mentioned it before. It sounds almost incredible when you first hear it, but you see things like this. Yeah.
Is it that if you don't use their same method?
Woo. What is your name?
Jocelyn.
Jocelyn, that's right. That wasn't the one I was thinking of, Jocelyn, but it's, I mean, I don't want to be triumphalist about this, but yours is just as good. If you don't use their weapons, you have moved the whole struggle onto a very advantageous location for you. So if you don't respond to their bombing, you have, in a way, invalidated the whole thing. The principle that I was thinking of is where Gandhi says, evil has no existence. It seems to exist because we support it. And one of the ways we support it is if somebody threatens us, we get frightened. That supports their threat. If somebody threatens us and we don't get frightened, we've withdrawn our support. And that evil ceases to exist. Then it's just a big noise. And some molecules banging around. So that was one thing that happened. And the other thing that I want to draw attention to, and in this case I actually do have the right page in the right book, so let's enjoy it. This was Wednesday night, November 14th, they decided to call off the struggle because it was no longer necessary. That night, the Ku Klux Klan rode. Now, of course, that's special language. When the Klan rides, they are in effect being a posse. They're being, this is a special social form within the scapegoating dynamic where it's called a German word. Actually, the desk was getting a little hard anyway, so I'm gonna write something on the board. This is called a Männerbund because it was first discovered by German scholars actually on the eve of World War II, interestingly enough. Männerbund is a gang, group, and Männer just means of men. So it's male sodality, but it has a special meaning because groups of men sometimes get together for a violent purpose, and they seem to enclave themselves out of reach of society and its norms, and they become extremely dangerous. This happened a lot in Middle Ages, in Norse countries. In some cases, there were communities in Greece where they actually trained the young men to form parts of these raiding bands where their only purpose becomes extreme dehumanizing violence. And it's almost like these groups that run around in the woods, you know, tearing apart animals, things like that. So this phenomenon is extremely dangerous. So now let me read the paragraph, which you probably have already read. Ordinarily, threats of Klan action were a signal to the Negroes to go into their houses, close the doors, pull the shades, or turn off the lights. Fearing death, they played dead. And this guy really knows how to write. Fearing death, they played dead. You remember that essay that I gave you in the reader from Howard Thurman? That it's when you internalize the untruth and start lying to protect yourself that you've completely lost. Okay, fearing death, they played dead. But this time, they had prepared a surprise. When the Klan arrived, according to the newspapers, about 40 carloads of robed and hooded members, porch lights were on and doors open. As the Klan drove by, the Negroes behaved as though they were watching a circus parade. Concealing the effort it cost them, remember that phrase, we're going to comment on that. Concealing the effort it cost them, many walked about as usual. Some simply watched from their steps, and this is really rich. A few waved at the passing cars. Hi, you know, y'all come back. After a few blocks, the Klan, nonplussed, turned off into a side street and disappeared into the night. So what can we say about this? Start off by saying if we are thinking about rhythm, this is an important element. They have now played their worst card. They have done their most terrifying thing, and it doesn't work. Camilla?
Yeah, and it's like that thing that you were just talking about, that evil has no existence.
Yeah.
It
is definitely an example of the fact that when you withdraw your participation from evil, and nobody's saying it's easy, but if you withdraw your participation, the thing loses its power, and without any power, you might as well say it doesn't exist. Julia?
I was wondering if you knew what the Klan was trying to convey by burning the cross. What did that mean exactly?
What I have never been able to figure out what the Klan means by burning the cross. That is a very, you know, I've never been initiated. I don't even know how to cross my left hand over my right. I don't have a clue what those guys are getting at. But as someone who looks at symbols quite apart from what people think they're doing, to me, part of the symbolism there, it's ambiguous, as much symbolism is, especially in the realm of violence. Partly, burning the cross, they're burning down Christianity. Because Nietzsche said, you know, Judeo-Christian religion has made us weak, and nothing is worse than that. We should no more Mr. Nice Guy. And of course, the Nazis picked that up. This is not what he meant, but they didn't care what he meant. They picked it up and used it. So partly they're saying, if you think that the cross is going to protect you, we're dousing it with gasoline and putting it on fire. Another possible interpretation of that, and you know, it's really hard to know how symbols work sometimes. Another possible interpretation is they are taking, you remember my model that religions deteriorate over time in three stages. They get down to a point where they have nothing but their authority, and that authority is now used for exactly the opposite of what the religion originally stood for. So here what they're doing is they are asserting Christianity as a religion of violence. It is coming with flames, so to speak. And that would fit very well the apocalyptic mentality of a lot of the fundamentalists, who are practically a third of our country right now, actually. Scary. I bet that's not to say a third of our country would go on a Klan ride and put on an old Cannon Purcell sheet with eye holes cut in it, but are part of this mentality that mine eyes have seen glory of the coming of the Lord trampling down the vineyards and all the rest of it. That's about the best that I can make of that. I've always maintained that it's difficult to understand insane people, and so that I think that's about the best that I can do. Okay, so with the bombing and with this extremely dramatic episode of a Klan ride that fizzles out, I think we're looking at something equivalent to the Darsan assault pants, so that at least within the Montgomery episode, this is now the climax. The Klan has done its worst, and it doesn't work. So at this point, nonviolence has prevailed. But now, yes, John? Good, yeah, sure, you bet. This is a nonviolent moment, yeah. We've got to get this into our film, as a matter of fact, yeah. You know, it happens to be one that was instigated by the bad guys. As you know, I don't believe in bad guys, but if I do, these would certainly qualify. This was started by them, but it does bring it out into the open. Okay, they've got their powers on the table, our power is on the table, and I maintain that whenever you can really do this in a clean, nonviolent conversation, nonviolent power will always prevail. And this was clearly an example of that. Great, but I did make a fuss for some irrational reason about the phrase concealing the effort it cost them. Now your question is, why is Nagler so excited about this phrase? concealing the effort it cost them. So I, yes, Jocelyn. When the Klan threatens them, that is a form of violence. Before they get out of the car and start swinging their pipes and stuff, it's still violence. You could say it's almost as extreme. It just hasn't moved into the area of physical expression yet. And so they are, these people are dealing with that violence. Yeah, Rami?
In their own sort of way, they're taking on suffering.
Yes. Yes. They're taking on suffering. It would have been much easier. Go inside, shut out the lights. This Melba Beals that I've mentioned, who writes this book about the Little Rock. Oh, I did want to talk about that episode. Anyway, they attacked her home one time, and it was the father was no longer living with them, so it was just her and her grandmother and her mother. And what they did not realize was that grandma had a shotgun in the closet, so all these people are making a lot of noise on the front porch, being very threatening, we're coming in. So Grandma India just levels down on a trash can in the front yard and shoots this trash can with a shotgun. Well, you can imagine what kind of noise that made. And in 2 seconds, those people were out of there. So that is one response. Another response is to crawl under the bed and pretend you're not there. And I would say that both of these are like fight and flight. So they're both in the general area of violence. But if you want to get in the general area of nonviolence, you got to walk out and look at those people going by in the convertible and maybe even see those eyes of hatred and wave at them. And the reason that I am so enamored of this phrase, concealing the effort that it cost them, is if you go right back to the first day of the course, you know, get that webcast, you will see that my definition of nonviolence is that it's a power that arises from the conversion of negative energies. And this concealment was actually turning fear into a constructive outlet. So while they're concealing the emotion of fear, the energy, the drive behind that emotion is propelling them out there. And I don't know if you've ever had this experience, but have you ever been in a situation where you were afraid and you decided to act as though you were not afraid and you were just convinced that you were a complete flop and everybody saw through it because you were so scared and you felt that your teeth were chattering, and at the end people come up to you and they say, "How could you do that without a trace of fear? Man, you were so cool." And you smile and say, "Oh, well, I always do it that way." in other words, the emotion of fear is a little bit like a slideshow that's being put on in a part of your mind. And you can withdraw your attention from it, and your energies can go in a very different direction. Now, it's also in the context of Montgomery that or maybe it was a little bit later in the movement as a whole, where King made his famous statement that there were no explosions of anger. Rather, we controlled anger and released it under discipline for maximum effect. It's a perfect expression of this psychological dynamic. And this is a clue to why Gandhi said, "Give me an angry, violent person and I can turn him into a nonviolent satyagrahi. But don't give me a wimp. I can't do anything with one of those." Well, he didn't use the word, but you know what I mean. So I think that we have just a little psychological insight that this is the actual power of nonviolence at work. You have a negative response in you, fear, obviously. I mean, it's scary even to read about this paragraph. The fear comes up. You decide not to act on it in either of the two traditional ways. You're going to do something creative instead. The energy of that fear actually rolls over into the creative action. This is important enough, I want to dwell on it for just a minute more. The clue for me was when I first read about that experiment by Davids, which is in my book right toward the beginning, where they took this two classrooms of school children, right at the same time, actually, as Montgomery. And remember, they trained one group to be, they just let group one group be very aggressive, and the other group, they wanted them not to be aggressive. They subjected both groups to exactly the same frustration experience, and it was hair-raising even to read about it. You give them candy, you tell them not to eat it yet, and then you sit them down, you tell them they're going to be watching movies. They had something called movies in those days. You put them in a big projector. And then you snap the lights on, say, no more movies, get back to your classroom, give me that candy bar. You can't imagine doing anything more frustrating and cruel to these school children. But then they carefully watched the two groups, and the groups that were trained to be aggressive, well, you can just imagine, they were super aggressive. You know, they were punching each other out, probably tied up the teacher, set fire to the classroom. So then you go over to the other group expecting it to be a little bit less dramatic. And not only is it a little bit less dramatic, but unprepared for this, what the scientists saw was that the cooperative trained students were super cooperative. They were being so nice. It was like almost disgusting already. No, I don't want this. You can have it. But sure, it's my only piece of candy, but who cares? You're my friend. That kind of thing. So the only explanation is that you have this frustration energy, which is very negative, which could take all these negative forms, but you have carved a different channel for it to flow through. And it goes out in creativity. So I think it is worth our having stayed on that for a while, because this is the bedrock, this is the core of nonviolence. Okay, let's see. While we're talking about this fear question, there's an interesting observation. When the attacks get started in Montgomery, King gets hold of a gun, keeps it in his house. Now, you know, it's kind of a natural reaction, right? People are attacking you out of the darkness, through terrorism. You want to reach for the gun. And the house is being patrolled by armed bodyguards. And at one point, they thought about this and decided that this doesn't work. You know, this is not nonviolence, and I don't want anyone with guns around here. And he gets rid of his own gun, and he says, "I was much more afraid in Montgomery when I had a gun in my house. When I decided that I couldn't keep a gun, I came face to face with the question of death, and I dealt with it. From that point on, I no longer needed a gun, nor have I been afraid. Had we become distracted by the question of my safety, we would have lost the moral offensive," he uses that language, "and sunk to the level of our oppressors." That's your point, Jocelyn, that we've been using their weapons. So he's learning from direct experience exactly what the dynamics of nonviolence are and what they demand. I'm reminded of Jeanette Rankin. I don't know how many of you are aware of her. She was the first female congressperson in the U.S., and she went to Congress just in time, 1916, to vote against the entry of the U.S. into World War I. And she made a famous statement, "I love my country, but I cannot vote for war. I say no." And it was one against 495 in the two houses. And after she made that statement, she was mobbed. I remember she's the only woman in the House, and she's against war. This goes along with what I said before. You know, you can take away racism, you can take away a lot of things, but if you start tugging on people's war-fighting capacity, they're going to fight back with everything they've got, unfortunately. But that's something for us to know. Think of the Greek junta. I mean, I don't often encourage people to think of the Greek junta, but here was in power for 8 or 10 years. Nobody could dislodge it. And then they decided to raise an army and send it to Cyprus. They failed to raise that army. They resigned to a man. They just walked out and say, if we can't fight wars, we're nobody. So that's how they think. Anyway, you can imagine how outraged they were against Jeanette Rankin. She actually had to run into a telephone booth in the rotunda of the House of Representatives and had to be protected by policemen. It was a terrifying experience seeing all these colleagues, you know, pounding on the glass, get her out of there. Just imagine. She was so terrified that she needed a vacation, went down to a cabin in the Piney Woods in Georgia and was recuperating. And one night she couldn't sleep. She was terrified. And she didn't quite know why. Every time a pine cone dropped, which happens frequently in the Piney Woods, she would jump out of bed, oh my God, they're coming. And she couldn't understand why. She'd been sleeping fine, you know, up until that night. In the morning, she discovered why she was so afraid. She had locked the door. Every night up to that point, she had not locked the door. But once she enacted fear, she was afraid. When she enacted danger, she responded to danger. So it's similar here, the similar discovery that King is making. It is very empowering to lay down the gun. Very empowering. We even have an episode about that in our DVD. Okay, I've got about 95 other major points I wanted to make and 117 minor ones, but we're out of time. We have one more minute in case you had any questions you want to raise. Again. Okay, fine. Well, on Tuesday then, we're going to take a bit of a step back and look at the combined legacy. I think you have in your reader a little diagram called the Wheel of Nonviolence, and we'll be talking partly about that. Okay. Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, please hand me your proposals at this point. I knew there was something else.